Hello, you beautiful nerds. Welcome to the Drunk Banthas podcast, where we talk about sci-fi, fantasy, horror, and all the popular art that we love.
Also, we do it drunk.
Mostly drunk.
Mostly.
Always encouraged, but never mandatory. I'm joined, as always, by my co-host and brother, Bill. How you doing?
I'm doing great, man. I'm doing great. But let me just tell you, Alex, we're sitting here pre-recording for a reason, right?
Yeah, that's right.
That's right, man. We're
very
here
special episode.
Doing a interview with our special guest. You want to go ahead and introduce our special guest?
I'm so glad that you asked. Oh, of man. Course, I would be more than happy to. She is an actor, dancer, gymnast, activist, stunt performer. She played Lai on the Kung Fu TV series Warrior. Guys, welcome to the show, Jenny Mbuha. Welcome. Thank you so much for joining us on this convo today.
Boom.
What's up, guys? Thank you for having me.
Of course, of course.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for joining us. I'm so glad that you're here. Can't say enough about your performances. Man, I'm so glad that we can get to this interview.
Yeah. We are huge fans of the show, and especially a huge fans of your performance and your character. So we're really excited to talk to you. We're kind of curious of, what was your upbringing like, and like how you got inspired to pursue your career path? Because we know that you're a dancer. Is that how you started out in your career? Or
it was actually artistic gymnastics. I did that for about 13 years. Yeah, I competed nationally and internationally, and basically I met two stunt guys at a tricking workshop, and they were kind of just like, you have some kind of skill level, would you be keen to do some workshops of stunts? And I had really never heard of stunts at the time. It wasn't really a known job. But anyways, I went to the workshops, and I fell in love with it. I mean, who doesn't want to play make-believe 24/7?
That is a great way to put it. Yes, absolutely.
And stunt performing does seem like a particularly fun yet challenging job. Does have you found it to be more challenging than other aspects of the entertainment, like dancing or acting?
It's definitely more challenging because as a stunt performer, you have to be able to play so many different roles and learn so many different forms of martial arts or dancing or acrobatics or fighting. Like in a normal person, you kind of either do gymnastics or dancing or, but in stunts, you kind of have to be able to do a little bit of everything. So I always say we're the jack of all trades, but a master of none,
Oh, well, you've definitely mastered this one, for sure.
Absolutely. I wouldn't say mastered yet, but I'm getting there.
got it. Well, you could kick our asses. That's all.
That's what people think, but honestly, I'm the biggest lover. I don't like conflict. I don't like actually hitting people. It's just all for show.
Right. It's performance. It's acting. Yeah,
she's acting. She's a great performer. Now, what was it like to play? Because I was always curious, because Lai is one of my favorite characters on Warrior. And you did a phenomenal job with the performance, especially she doesn't have a whole lot of dialogue, so a lot is coming through your performance on your face. It's an incredible performance. What was it like playing a character who had so much trauma, prior to the events of the show? And also, she also goes through her own struggles through the series. What was it like playing someone who's just so, so sad and so, so angry?
Lots of trauma. No, I've actually been asked this question before, and I said it's weird, but the acting without words is basically what we do for stunts on a daily basis. When we're doubles or when we're just doing background and stuff, we're not allowed to talk. So we kind of have to act with our bodies and our facial, actions and stuff. So when I got the role of Lai, it was the most perfect role I could have asked for. No words, no lines, just kind of only emotions with the face. And that's kind of what I do on a daily basis. So in that regard, it was actually pretty easy to roll into this role. But it's also the help of my castmate, Olivia Chang. She's phenomenal, and she makes the scene so real that it kind of helps me as well. And we all just kind of, feed off each other within the scenes and stuff like that. So it was definitely not challenging. I'd say the most challenging part was trying to cry on command, because that's something that I'm not very good at. But again, I just got so much advice from everybody around me that it was for me, it was such a wonderful and easy show, you know?
Yeah, no, you definitely knocked that portion out of the park. I don't understand why you don't do more or have other roles, like, you know, outside of stunt performing, because definitely you killed it on that one.
Thank you. I would love that. Honestly, I think my next step in my journey is to do more like acting stunts together.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, we'll see. Who knows? Maybe I'll take a couple acting courses and hopefully I'll find myself somewhere in Hollywood.
Maybe she could be in the next Girl Kills world instead of Boy.
That was shot in South Africa, huh?
Oh no, yeah. I didn't know that.
Yeah, it was shot in South Africa. Yeah, yeah. I had a lot of good mates on there.
Also, Andrew Koji on.
And Andrew Koji, exactly.
It's all tied together. Everything's tied to Warrior. Yeah, it's crazy.
Hollywood, like, just take the cues. Go ahead and get Jenny for the sequel. Let's just get it going.
Let's just get it going.
And it does seem like, you know, a lot.
I'll play her voice.
Yes, yes, that would be so cool.
I just want, so you're from South Africa, correct?
I am, yes. Born and raised.
Born and raised, you know what I'm saying? Okay, so I'm just curious. How does someone go from being in South Africa, dancer, performer, gymnast, and then you become a Cirque du Soleil performer? Like, how does that, because I don't know how you even go from being a regular person to being in a regular circus, but Circus Ole, that's pretty crazy. So yeah, how did that happen?
Well, I had auditioned, and I should get these dates right, but I really don't know the date of it. I had auditioned for it as a dancer, but I am, like, everybody thinks my predominant background is dancing. It's actually not. Dancing came later on in life, after school. I had kind of got into hip hop because I really wasn't very rhythmic. My dancing ability was not very great. So I learned it basically as I went on. But I'd auditioned for Cirque du Soleil via dancing. We had like 200 and something dancers in Cape Town. And we basically had a 2-day audition where they were going to pick 8 people to be on the database. And once you're on the database, you can either get a call the next day or in 5 years, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah. And in my case, it was 5 years. It was a long time. I mean, just making the database was huge because I think in every country, they only have a certain amount of people they can put on the database. Mm-hmm. So already in itself, that was like the biggest achievement of my life. But then 5 years later, you know, getting that call from Cirque being like, hey, we've got a stunt show. Are you keen to join? I was like, I'm in.
Yeah, that is dope, man.
Oh yeah. Yeah,
that also seems like one of those jobs that were, yeah, you can't, like, like stunt performing, there's it takes a lot of skill, like not just being a great dancer, gymnast. It, like, it incorporates a lot of things that you're really skilled at.
It definitely does. Luckily, well, not luckily, but this specific Cirque show wasn't all the beautiful Cirque acts you often see and know of with Cirque, like, you know, very aerialistic stuff and things. It was more stunt-based, dancer-based, like biking. We had a lot of that on. So they tried to get this new show for the younger audience.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, I mean, the idea was great. There was very big potential to it. I think in the end, we definitely could have done a lot better with the production side of stuff. But in itself, I was there for what, a year and a half altogether. It was the most amazing experience. And then COVID hit. So I was like, it's COVID. It's okay. Yeah.
Oh, man. So did you travel? Like, where did all take you, Cirque du Soleil? Does that take you like all throughout South Africa? Does it take you all throughout Europe or, you know, like America?
Yeah, so my first 5 weeks, when it's basically like your training and coming up with part of the show, that was in Montreal, Canada.
Oh.
Yes, so I was there for about 5-6 weeks, and then we all located to our like home, which was Las Vegas.
Mm, right, Las Vegas.
Yeah, so I just stayed in Las Vegas. It was the best experience of my life, and I would move back to Las Vegas in a heartbeat.
Oh, really? Awesome.
Yeah. Oh yeah,
in Vegas, man! Shout out to everybody in Vegas.
Yeah, oh man, love it.
We got friends in Vegas. Actually, that's cool. Yeah,
yeah, we do. Next time you're through, we'll just you got a couch to crash on.
Exactly. Amazing. I'll keep you with that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Man, yeah, because say the reason I asked is because I've seen a Cirque du Soleil in Los Angeles.
Okay.
Like they set up it was actually interesting. They set up a tent outside of Dodger Stadium. Okay. So that's what I was asking. Like, how does it take you around the world? Does it just take you to Vegas? Does it take you? But you, that's crazy. I didn't know that. Like, they had like a
residence,
a base.
Yeah. So they have. Canada. Well, I think after COVID, a lot of the shows did stop, but they had like 5 resident shows in Vegas, and then they had 7 traveling shows. But yeah, since Vegas, since COVID, it's been. And the shows are less. There's also less traveling shows, so they're either trying to come up with that. You know, there's a lot of politics involved as well. It was a good experience. It really was.
Good. Yeah. So my last question was: were you one of the people who's doing all the like crazy positions and like doing all the crazy stuff, or were you doing like trapeze stuff?
No, I wasn't. I was a dancer and a stunt performer, so we just did a lot of fighting. We did burns on stage. We did lots of wire like fold outs, and then a nice little dance piece in the middle. So yeah, the show, like I said, it could have been better. They should have added more of the trapeze and the acrobatics and stuff like that, but I think they should give it a second chance, though it's really like a long time ago now. It's like 4 years, I think.
Oh yeah, damn. Yeah, is that long?
Wow. It is long. I don't know if I could do that again. You know, I'm not a spring chicken anymore.
Do you think that that experience like helped like inform your like stunt performing career and like acting career going forward? Because it seems like it's a very physical position
and a lot of acting, yeah, for sure.
Yes. So Cirque, I would say, was a lot different. Maybe in the stunt side, like it helped me with stamina, I would say, because the shows are like back to back, 2 shows a night, you know, you're really just running from like one part of the stage to the other all the time. But I don't think it really did anything to my stunt or my acting career in that regard. Though it's like one of those things on my bucket list that I kind of checked off, you know, so it was a big achievement of mine and I'm so glad I took it. And there's actually a little FYI, the season 2 of Warrior, mm-hmm, the reason I got sent to Nelly's Farm is because I went to Cirque.
Really?
Oh,
man. So, yes, I had spoken to Jonathan Tropper, who's an amazing writer and producer, and I had come to him and said, I just got a call from Cirque du Soleil. This has been a dream of mine since I was a little kid, you know, and I don't know what to do because my character was finally getting some really cool stuff on season 2. We were just starting to shoot and I was like sitting there really unsure of what to do. So he sat me down and he said, if you were my daughter, I would say go. And he says, we'll figure everything out for Lai. Don't worry about it. Like it's in, you know, I've got it. Don't worry. And he sent me away to Nelly's Farm, so I didn't have to die or anything at that point, you know? And I managed to come back on season 3.
Amazing. That's amazing. So, like, that speaks to, I feel like, from the outside looking in, that speaks to me, like, how well you all get along. Like, it seems like everybody from the cast to the production, yeah, to, you know, like, costume designers, makeup, like you guys seem to be a pretty tight knit group of people.
We were family, you know, and it was the most amazing show I've worked on. I think I haven't gotten along with the stunt team, the actors, the production, the cast, the crew, everybody. Haven't gotten along with everybody ever in my life on a show. So like for us, we're all still in contact with each other. Whenever we get a chance to be in a country or whatever, we'll all meet up, you know. So Warrior was like unlike anything I've ever done.
Yeah, incredible. That's incredible. So speaking of that, I kind of jumped around on my questions, but since you guys are so close.
Yes. Oh no.
Who is your favorite cast member?
Oh my gosh, that's so
I'm putting you on the spot. Like, who is your favorite? You know, like, it could be anybody. It could be anybody.
Everybody's lovely. Like the level is so high, and it's everybody's all on this, like, perfect plateau of a level. But there's just that one person that goes, a little bit higher.
Exactly. Yeah, that one. Like we all got. If you got kids, like people got kids, they love all the kids. But they got that one that they love.
It's Olivia, a toy.
Olivia.
Yes. Oh my gosh.
She's so lovely. She's like this, you know, this big sister that she just like took me under her wing from day one. And we've just become so close over the years. So even to this day, we still chat. We still, you know, hang out. And yeah, just a few months ago, I was in Canada and I just went to go say hi to her. So yeah.
I saw that she was in like Alabama one time and I was like, holy shit.
We're so close.
We're from Alabama and we're just like, oh, why would anybody be there on purpose?
It's crazy. Oh, that's cool.
But you know, you got you ladies remind me of like a like it's almost like y'all are like they only do this in comedy where it's like a comedy duo, but
yeah,
you got like a dramatic duo. Like you got y'all are like two peas in a pod. I mean, like when y'all are on camera together, it's just electricity, even though y'all don't have to be saying anything half the time. Like, it's crazy.
So that's the fun part. It's like on set, in front of camera, on the series, you can see our connection is so close and it's just as close off screen. Mm-hmm. And we're actually the complete opposite to on screen. We're just like a bunch of fools with each other. So we're just super like, you know, goofy and weird with each other. And that kind of is what helps also the chemistry and the connection with Lion Atoy.
Yeah, it definitely comes out on screen. Like that opening, I think it's season two opening scene with you, her, and Andrew. I was like, I could watch 18 seasons of just this scene. Oh, you guys going from warehouse to warehouse, just killing racist guys.
Just killing, y'all just out here killing Whitey.
I would love that. I wish they would have done a spin-off of just like Atoy and Lai just like slaughtering people, you know?
I'm here for it, to be honest. Like a B-side short type thing. Warriors B-side shorts. Just Atoy and Lai just murdering everybody. I'm here for it, actually. I'll pay for that.
I'll buy a streaming service just for that. That's the only show on that streaming service I will buy.
And like, I have to give it up to Liv. She is such a talented like performer in general because she does so much of her like movements and stuff as well, you know, with the sword and all of that. I mean, she has a double who's also phenomenal. I mean, she's a phenomenal sword girl. Her name is Yao. But Olivia in herself can move as well. She was an ex-gymnast too. So, you know, like just doing all of this with her, it's so much fun.
Yeah, I can't even imagine how much fun y'all be having on set. Man. This is crazy. Because I wasn't expecting you to say Olivia, but like I kind of was hoping you would say Olivia.
Who did you think I was close with? That's a good question.
I didn't really know. I was like, man, I wonder who she's going to say.
That's interesting. Because usually when people like have this podcast with me, they're like, you and Olivia are besties, aren't you? I was like, besties, but definitely we have such a good chemistry and such a good connection. So, yeah.
Well, you know, you'd probably assume it's somebody like Andrew, somebody like that, somebody who has more of a martial arts background or a stunt performer background.
Yeah.
So I guess maybe I would have thought, if I had to guess, like just gun to my head, I would have said Andrew. But you never know. You have no idea.
It's
you know, I'm like in my mind, you know, everybody's sitting there smoking cigarettes, you know, sitting on the side, like, hey man, that's crazy, man. She can't do that shit, man. You know? So, but it's not clicky. Y'all are like, you know, I don't know, like just completely together, it seems connected, 100% connected. So to that point, I just want to ask, like the other day, actually. Day before yesterday, we interviewed Michael Clyatt from Shogun. He's the VFX supervisor on Shogun. And nice. I was like, curious, how much interaction do you have, like stunt performers or on Warrior in general? How much do y'all have to like communicate with the VFX? Because there has to be VFX on this show, I'm assuming.
Yes, no, definitely. We do. Well, we do try to all have a really good connection with each other because obviously each department helps each other out. So, you know, anything from VFX, SFX, costume, hair, makeup, like we all try to really work in unison. So, you know, we all have a good bond with each other. But usually our heads, our coordinators will have a better connection with the SFX or VFX people, you know. But I definitely try to have a good personal relationship with everybody. It's because it makes it easier at the end of the day, you know.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. I figured that you might have some kind of communication with them, but like, because I was talking to them, at least on that show, they have to be extremely detailed with everything because it's basically like 70% CGI. How much of this show deals with a lot of CGI as far as the stunts go? Because you got a lot of blood splatter, a lot of weaponry, you know what I mean?
There's definitely a few. I wouldn't say it's a lot because actually they did very good with prosthetics and stuff. Okay. So the prosthetic stuff were really well done. I think there's not a lot of green screen things that we did for Warrior. I mean, there are the odd few, like the, I don't know if you remember on season 3 in the pub fight with Leary, there's a mouth, like a mouth smash against, that is definitely SFX and VFX.
I remember.
It's gnarly. It's disgusting. And you cannot do that without that. So he had to get his whole face like molded and prosthetic up and whatever. And so there you have to work with the different departments, you know. Also with my boyfriend who was on Warrior, I dropped him on the head after the fire.
Yep.
Yeah. And he had to get also the prosthetic slit on. And there's a lot of aspects that play into it. So yes, we do have to do a lot of special effects on a lot of the stuff.
Oh yeah, okay, cool. That, I mean, that's awesome. You chopped your boyfriend's head in.
Now that you can say that, not get taken to jail.
No, not at all.
But that's all thanks to Brett Chan. Like, he is so great as a coordinator. He was like, Jenny, you're gonna kill your boyfriend, and like in a really gruesome way. And I was like, yes, let's go.
You know what? Speaking of this, since we're talking about your boyfriend, I think I might know the answer to this question. Who is your favorite stunt performer? You can't pick your boyfriend. You gotta pick somebody else. You can't pick your boyfriend. You gotta pick somebody out there. It doesn't have to be from this show either. It could be anybody. Who is your favorite? Like, who do you look out and go, damn, I wish I had thought of that, or I wish I had done that. Dang, I can't do that. Like, who is that?
There's a lot. There's a shit ton of really good performers. I'm sorry, but like,
they don't get enough love. You know, we love stunt performers here. We talk about it all the time.
Okay, female Heidi Moneymaker. She's really, there's actually two. Heidi Moneymaker and Aurelia Agel from France. Those two females, amazing. Though, not even like close to competition, they're like 1.7 meters tall, you know, blonde, like super powerful woman. So like in that regard, but they're brilliant at what they do. With males, Koji's double, Jason Lee. He's from Hong Kong. He is phenomenal.
Shout out to Jason Lee.
Yeah. No, it's, I mean, honestly, I surround myself with the most amazing stunt performers. And I've been lucky enough to work with a few people that I'm just like so in awe of. So really, like for me, everybody is my idol. And I just try to take as much information and guidance from them as possible.
Shout out to Jason Lee.
Yeah.
Money with her, man. Like those ladies, both of them, right? Like they got their sisters, right? There's two of them, right?
Heidi Moneymaker does. I think her younger sister is in the biz as well. Yeah. Such a great name too.
Moneymaker. Dude.
Right? Sounds like Hollywood.
I have to imagine that their breath stinks or something. Like you can't have everything. You can't have everything. You can't be like perfect. You can't be friggin' 6 foot blonde, beautiful, gym just jumping all over the place, whipping people's ass. And your breath has to be
talent for the rest of us.
Exactly. Your breath has to be smelly, or your feet. something has to be weird. How did you end up getting the role on Warrior? So, because if I'm not mistaken, you were on the you were just like a stunt performer on the show at first. But how did you end up getting on the show? How did you end up becoming Lye? Like, how did all that work out?
Yes, you're right. I was a stunt performer. I was like the background stunts, you know. But I had to worm my way into Warrior because I was on a different show at the time. And we were all like shooting in the same studios. But I had heard that this show called Warrior is coming and it's going to be huge and Bruce Lee and whatever. So I kind of just like wormed my way into their studios and I was watching their training and I was like, oh my God, like I have to get in there. So I like one day I was just like, hi, my name is Jenny, you know, and I just kind of like forced my face in there. And I had a good chat with Brett and he was like, well, I didn't know there's Asian performers in Cape Town. Like, you know, come over and let's see if we can slot you in at some point. So I did a little bit of background on season one where in the, at always, what is that, brothel downstairs where everyone has the drinks and stuff. And, you know, they started the fight, so we had to fall over chairs and tables. So I was there. And then I doubled, like, one girl as well. She was one of the courtesans, and I had to double her. But then I got really close with Brett and the stunt team, and he was telling me that there's potentially a role that they want to put me forward for. They don't know what the role is yet, but it would be a lot of fighting. And at the time, like, I was like, I'm down, like, let's go, you know. So they sent me a script of Mai Ling. It was like a monologue of hers, and they said, just audition with this, you know, like, just so we can see what you look like on camera. So I did my audition, I sent in my self-tape, and I think within a month I had a phone call with JT. And I had to put my hair in pigtails and make myself look like I was 14 because that was the character they wanted. And he was like, we love you and we would love to put you on as Lye. She's mute, which I was like, yes. She's mute and she kicks ass. She's a vigilante. So I was like, and they were like, and she's 16. So we're going to have to try and, like, you know, keep you looking young. So they cut my bangs and everything like I have now. And I at 24, I played a 16-year-old vigilante.
I mean, that's something to tell your grandkids about. You know what I mean? Like, you know, hey, you know, when I was 24, I was looking good. Now I'm just trying to tell you, look, that's how I rolled back in the day.
Oh man, it's not the same anymore, though. I can't say that anymore.
Well, it's interesting. You still play children. I mean, you know, you've done stunt work for Wednesday.
Yep. Yeah. And she was 17 at the time. That was 2 years or 3 years ago.
Look at that. Yeah. That's crazy.
You still got it. Still got it.
You know, my height, I always double kids. So my youngest I doubled was like 11.
How tall are you?
More
short,
I guess. 5'1".
5'1". Okay, yeah. Cool. Because you can't trust, you know, Wikipedia or nothing like that.
So yeah. What did they say I am? Like 6 foot?
well, actually, they were close. They said 5'2". So
yes. Yeah, yeah, yeah. So yeah, 5. I always get confused because we don't do feet. We do a.
Oh yeah, 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 yeah. That's right.
So how many? 6 centimeters.
Centimeters? Y'all do it in centimeters, not meters?
Well, 156 meters.
Okay. 100. Okay. Look, I'm just curious. I'm like
5'6" meters.
I'm terrible with it. All Americans are.
Yeah, we're the weirdos over here.
We're terrible at all of that stuff. But
we tried to convert for you guys, but it becomes a bit off sometimes.
No, exactly. That's what's crazy. Y'all are way, way, way more intelligent than us. I mean, that's y'all. I mean, everyone outside of the borders of the United States of America. That's everybody's doing conversions for us. Like we fucking get it.
We decided to do something stupid. A long time ago.
Exactly. We decided, well, fuck everybody else.
But how often do we have to send in our like sizes and they want it in feet and inches and all kinds of stuff? So I'm like, we have to learn, you know?
Yeah, y'all just have to man, that's crazy. Being a superpower is crazy, Alex. That's a whole different podcast, you know. Being a superpower is hard, man.
Oh man.
Back on, well, actually, I'm gonna ask you a couple of questions about Wednesday. Like how, because that had a lot of CGI and stuff, like intense is it being on that show? Because you, or at least for the stunts that you have to perform, because you did not just play Wednesday, right? Like you did a few other perform like stunts as well, right?
Yes. So, I mean, predominantly I was Wednesday's double. So that already takes up a lot of space and time, you know. But obviously, I doubled. Well, I was supposed to double Emma for one of the stuff, but then my boyfriend was there, so he was in the green suit doubling Emma as the wolf. Yeah. But in the stunt gym, we test everybody's gags because there was only three performers. It was myself, my boyfriend, and another South African stunt dude that was with us. So we were the only three really testing out everybody's stunts. But yeah, I was supposed to also double Eugene. Yes, Eugene was who's a who boy. He's a little boy, you know. And then I had to play like background stunts too. So we were kept busy throughout the 8 months in Romania. It was a long one, but it was really good.
Yeah, that sounds intense.
Yeah,
because I just was looking at the doing research for this. I was just like, man, is she just in this whole movie? I mean, this whole show.
Well, yeah, in theory, like whenever we get pulled on full time or like on a core team, it's 6 or 7 months of your life, you know, 5 days a week, sometimes 6 days a week for 10 to 12 hours a day. So we're just on all the time.
So if it's for anybody watching, probably not asking questions that you want us to ask. Like, we're not asking about a lot of warrior stuff, storyline stuff. We're just really interested in the beauty of stunt performers. Okay. Yeah. Like, we really want to get down to that because I feel like nobody gives stunt performers the love that they deserve. Yeah. You guys are like professional athletes. You know what I mean? You guys are like football players, basketball players. You know what I mean? Like we were talking about dance and all that. So where did it come from? Like, where does this come from? Your athletic prowess, you know, where does it come from? Did you play sports and growing up, or did you,
I would say it was gymnastics.
Gymnastics.
Yeah. I would say that I only had time for that. I went to a boarding school, which was a sports school. And from the age of 12 to 17. Yeah. 12 or 11 to 17. It was a sports boarding school. So I did sports in the morning, went to school, sports in the afternoon, homework, food, sleep. Same thing for a good couple of years. And even during my younger years, I got taken out of school for the last hour because I needed to do 4 to 5 hours of training in the evening. So I would say that would be probably a big part to play in me being a stunt performer today.
Wow, that's crazy. They got a boarding school in South Africa that's just putting out people who will whoop your ass. It's crazy. What are they planning on doing? Taking over the world? What is going on?
Well, I mean, sports schools are important, I think, in every country. I'm sure you guys have some too.
We have like very few. We have like really like two big ones, and they're basketball related.
Okay.
Oak Hill is one that I can think of. It's on the East Coast, Northeast Coast. But yeah, that we don't really do that here. We don't put an emphasis on things like that. And I think it would help a lot because we got a lot of great athletes here as well.
Oh, for sure. I mean, you guys have currently the most amazing Olympic team going, the gymnastics, autistic gymnastics females. You have three Olympians going in one for one country. So I think you guys are good.
Yeah, we're good. We're good. We're good. I'm just thinking about it like that. It's like, whoa, boarding schools directed for like what your talent is. Yes. Man.
But think about it. Those girls that are doing high performance gymnastics, they can go into stunts. They just choose not to. Because it's become a thing now where stunt performers are a thing. Like, people know of stunts now because of Fall Guy, because of all these other things that are coming up, of John Wick and all of that. So I'm like, it's out there. They just kind of choose not to do it. And that's okay, too, because as a gymnast, it is a different world. You know, gymnastics and stunts are two different things. Right. So it's like, okay, I'm going to choose this path. And whether it works or not, like, you know, and it's a long journey. I've been doing stunts for 11 years now, and only in the last 6 years have I actually worked consistently.
Wow. Yeah, that, you know, that I feel like it's, well, no, what were we about to say?
No, I was just gonna say, yeah, that does seem tough, and also like I can see how, like, just from your stunt performances, like you can see like there's like a certain elegance and like you make pretty much everything look incredibly easy, and so I think like that gymnast background really informs that a lot, because like you just seem so like elegant with all of your work.
Thank you. That's amazing to hear, because when we're rehearsing it, I am dying. What is that? Just repetition. Like, we just do it until we can do it from back to front to back, you know?
Which is like exactly why I was asking about Wednesdays, because that is just seems so rigorous. Like, that's just so intense, being on set as long as you have to be on. Yeah. And, you know, actors be complaining about just being on set for hours. Like, they ain't even got to do nothing. Yeah. Like, you're getting beat up, thrown up against trees, thrown around. Like, that's crazy.
That is weird, but sometimes we go to sets and we're just sitting around. Like, so, yes, there's the cool part of stunts where it's like all the cool stuff and you get hit by cars and set on fire and all these cool things. And then there's the other part of stunts where you get to sit and you're literally just doing this for like 12 hours. You have to wait for them to finish their acting scenes, or, you know, there's a lot of other stuff they need to shoot, and they're, you know, they're like, our stunts will do with second unit or whatever. So there's the very glamorous side of stunts, and there's also the not so glamorous side of stunts.
Come on, actors. Let's hurry up so we can get the stunts. Come on, man. Well, y'all got to do better, man. You know, get your shit how many together. Takes do you need? I mean, come on. I guess it's union regulations and whatnot, but so yeah, speaking of things being arduous, crazy, intense things that you have to do on set, somebody has to be getting hurt, and you must have suffered some type of injury. What on Warrior? Well, you can say anything, not just Warrior, but like, what would you say is like the craziest injury you've seen or sustained while doing this for the last 6 years?
I didn't personally see this accident happen, but I was on the same show at the time. But it was when Olivia lost her arm on Resident Evil. Olivia Jackson was the biker double.
Yeah.
Resident Evil, and a big accident happened, and they had to amputate her arm. So that was happening at the time when I was still in the same show.
Right. That is crazy.
That's a rough one. I was not expecting what that.
That's no. Rough. Yeah. I wrote the question down. Not expect. I was expecting like, oh, collarbone injury, broke it. I was.
Well, you asked for the biggest one. I mean, that was the biggest one.
No. That was
It's that's not always that crazy, you know. Like, that's just really like unfortunate. You know, it was a lot of different things that went wrong and things that could have been avoided. But yeah, that is by far, but like, we don't witness things like that very often.
Right.
Yeah.
So would you say like that put a stronger emphasis on safety, even though there's nothing but emphasis on safety, but you think that kind of changed a shift? Did you feel like it's a lot safer or a lot more checks and balances?
Definitely. Definitely. I think people started freaking out after that. Well, I mean, same as Harry Potter's double. He's paralyzed now, you know?
Yeah.
And so I think they're getting better year by year to keep the stunt performers more safe. But at the end of the day, there's a reason it's called stunt performing, because it comes with it certain amount of risk, you know? And we know that it's going to happen at some point in our career. And for me, luckily, there's been touch wood, but nothing too crazy. I just had a very bad burn. I was set on fire. It was a full body burn, and it was just too much. They said it was only going to be so high, and it kind of engulfed me completely. And I got third degree burns on my neck and my ears. And so that was probably the worst one I've had. But we know, you know, that it comes with the territory of being a stunt performer.
Right.
Yeah.
Or do stunt performers have a union? Like, are y'all part of SAG as well? Or are y'all just, or I guess this all over? I don't know what they are outside of this country, but
yeah. No, so America has SAG, Canada has their own thing, UK has their own thing. South Africa, we're trying to come up with our own thing. Obviously, we haven't figured it out just yet. But to a certain degree, we have insurance, I guess. Not fully, and we really should be looking into that. But yeah, usually the companies or the movie that you're working for should insure you for your or things that happen on set, you know?
That's good, because they just, it, from what I've seen and like the research, doing research, it seems like they just throw y'all in whatever. Like, hey, oh, hey, can you do this? Can you just jump your ass through a fucking fire real quick?
No, well, it is. I mean, like long term. So, say for example, Olivia's arm and things like that. I mean, I don't know to the extent of what the production actually paid for, but I know she was struggling to like with law, like you know, with lawsuits and stuff to get funding from them because at the end of the day, it's altered her life, you know, and she's pay out of pocket for physio and for all of those things. So, for me, that hasn't been figured out yet. Where the companies who are creating these should have insured their performers like for life if something happens like that, you know?
Yeah. So I don't know if what it is in America, but guys, we got to get a union, right? We got to get this stunt performers deserve their own little segment of union too. They shouldn't have to share nothing with the SAG,
right? And to y'all's point, like since stunt performing and with like the John Wicks the Fall Guy, like all these other like really stunt driven movies have become more popular, I feel like people are starting to catch wind of how important at this aspect of entertainment is how much people sacrifice for it. So so hopefully we're in a cornerstone right now where people, things are gonna stop.
It might not be in our, you know, it might not be in our lifetime, which might be sad, but like it might not be in our lifetime, it could be the next generation. But as long as something's moving, you know, as long as like the next generation is sorted and no matter what happens on set, like they're covered, I think then at least we know that whatever we did was not in vain.
Right. Exactly. Man, that sounded like we just did some civil rights movement type shit right now. Hell, that was deep.
Like, I have a dream.
Right now. That was beautiful. I wish I had a shot. I could do a shot right now. What was your favorite scene of yours? Because your character specifically gets the opportunity to decapitate and just straight up terrorize a lot of people. You get to fuck up a lot of people in this. You know, not parsing no words, you fuck up a lot of people. Anybody can get it. Well, so who was your favorite person to fuck up, or like what was your favorite moment or favorite scene that you
It's hard to say because in season two, definitely the fight with Atoy and I in that the big not the Teddy Boy fight. It was the one where it's just her and I, where we just fuck up a bunch of guys like, you know, simultaneously. Yeah. That one, best fight scene ever, you know. It was shot so well. Like the way it was shot, I was like, this is amazing, you know. So that one is season two. Season three, it's a tie between my one-on-one fight with Strickland, because that was the first, I mean, that's every stunt performer's dream, to have a one-on-one. It's your face, it's your moves, you know, you're getting to do this long ass fight, you know, and it's the first thing on what, episode 7 or 8 or something like that. It's literally the first like, you know, opening scene. So I'm like,
The first, because of the last, the first, the little, the end of the episode before starts out with you about and then we pick
that's
up right
an honor. That is such an honor to have your fight be the first thing of the episode. I'm like, that's huge. So that definitely, like, highlight of my life. I ticked that off my bucket list. But also being able to kill my boyfriend, because that was a huge fire jump. So we had to be on wires. It was through a ring of fire, you know, and then just coming directly on his head with a little tomahawk situation.
Yeah.
Amazing. So for me, I'm like, those two hand in hand are like the most amazing thing that Warrior's given me.
That's hilarious. Shout out to your boyfriend. He's a good sport, because you have such jubilance for killing his ass.
Well, we're doing tallies, so like throughout our careers together, we want to see how many times we can kill each other, you know.
Oh yeah, just do it. Yeah, Mark. Y'all got like marks on the wall. Okay, I'm leaking right now. Yeah, you better give it time. Figure it out. Man.
It's like I'm winning. You do the dishes.
He walks in and the scene just happens to be playing like on TV.
I'm sorry.
This is embarrassing. This is embarrassing. Yeah. it's your last scene, technically, right? That was your last scene on the show as well.
It's
like a hot cold open. It's the hottest cold open of all time. How was that when you're like reading the script, you're going through everything, and then you're like, oh, I'm gonna die. Yeah. How was that feeling?
Well, so because JT and I also have a really good relationship, the producer and writer, he had given me the heads up. He gave me a phone call before we even started prepping, you know, and he's like, have some news for you. And I had already kind of calculated it in my head. I was like, this is happening this season for sure. And part of me was like, I think I'm ready for it, because if we don't get a season 4, that's a good way to go, you know?
Oh, yeah.
So because season 3 came like 3 years later, and I'm getting older. I can't play a 16-year-old very much longer. It made sense. So when I got the phone call, like, you know, I knew it was happening. Obviously, it broke my heart. But I think I was more prepared for it than I thought. So it wasn't just like, I read and go, shit, I'm dying. It was more I had a chance to process it before we started.
Yeah.
And credit to the writers that, you know, with you having to take a pause from the show before, they were able to adjust the writing and not just like, we'll just kill her off. So it made when this part came around, not even knowing that story behind the scenes, you getting written in your death being written into the show, it felt natural. Like you said, it just felt like a natural progression of the character.
Speaking of season 3, are you expecting a season 4? Like a pickup, and if they brought your character back to life for some reason, like, oh no, she didn't die. She just
taking a nap and some blanket.
Taking a nap.
She just had some nap time in a blanket.
Oh, I wouldn't be brought back. I am officially out of the show. I'm crossing fingers for a season 4 because it deserves it, you know. And naturally, it's the most amazing show out there. And each season just gets better and better. So, I mean, if there's a season 4, it's going to be mind-blowing. But I would like to try and come on to still help out on the stunt side of stuff. But I just wouldn't be on as anybody. So, yes, that would be sad. But,
I figured that was the answer, but it's what people are going to want to hear on this interview. They're going to want to have heard that at some point. Oh, they didn't say season 4.
We're all hoping for it though, you know, so.
We are. That's like our biggest thing right now. It's like, yo, what the, first of all, why cancel it?
It's an incredible show.
It's an incredible show. Not given the love that it's supposed to be given, and that's why we try to give it the love that we give it all the time. We covered the show week to week when it went.
The third season. Yeah.
We really put an emphasis on, you know, because, you know, brown people around the world, we don't have a lot of love in Hollywood.
Yeah.
So whenever us brown people, I consider Asian people brown people. so we all want family, because in Hollywood it's just really hard to get a project like that off the ground, and to even be as big as it is now, it's beautiful thing. Did you have any, my last question, I guess, or one of my last questions before we get out of here, Shannon Lee, did you have any experiences with her, or did you ever get the, did you, how was that, if you did have experiences with her, what was that relationship like?
She's amazing. I really like, I was very fortunate on season 2, the end of season 2, I was able to actually like speak to her because I was more integrated into the cast side of stuff. And she had gifted me my Bruce Lee t-shirt, which I hold very dearly to my heart, you know. But she's just so lovely. And in season three, when she had a little cameo, you know, she came out as the mom. I got to help her out there as well. So, you know, we had a chance to work together too, which was amazing. We weren't in the same scenes, but I was able to help her out during her scene, you know, just help with her own stunts and stuff. And then yeah, at the end of the year, like we had a good chat and we wrote each other a nice little note, and it's been lovely. And to this day we're all still in a group chat where we, you know, we could converse with each other. So I mean, she's such a wonderful person and such an inspiration to everybody, you know. I mean, because of her, this warrior is here.
Absolutely. Yeah. You said it all right there, actually. I don't even want to step on any of that. That was perfect. We should cut that and like put some nice like music behind it. I'm telling you, that was good. That was perfect.
Great. Hopefully we can get her as the executive producer on Girl Kills World, the sequel.
Who do we have to kill to get this done?
What is happening? I can new voice, you know, like I was.
It's gonna be great. It's going to be absolutely amazing. And also just for you guys, like on behalf of like the Warrior crew, like thank you so much for always just being there and shouting for us and, you know, doing these podcasts, because it's amazing. Like really, I think we said the reason we got season three was thanks to people like you and, you know, cheering for us and giving us that second wind. So, or third wind for that one. But yeah, thank you.
Thank you. It's nothing for us. I mean, you know, a little subscription here, we'll pay for a little subscription there, and we're good to go. We can do it. Because I want to ask you before we get, this is my last question. This is definitely the last question. What was that period like in between the limbo of season two and season three? Like you said, it was 3 years before you guys got back on. That very rarely happens, if not never happens. Yeah. So what was that experience like?
It was weird. That was COVID time, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was COVID time. And there was a point where there was absolutely nothing. It was just dead silence. You know, we hadn't heard back from Shannon. We hadn't heard back from JT, not even from Brett. Like there was the whispers of it, but they were just like, you know, carry on your life. Do your life, you know, take the shows you guys want to. I don't know about Koji and Olivia because obviously they all had their own contracts and stuff. Right. But for the rest of us who were on, you know, season for season, they were like, just live your life. So we did. We carried on, went on core teams on other shows, and I went on to Wednesday and all of that. And I think we kind of got a little bit of whisper of season three probably at the beginning of 2021, would I say? Does that sound right?
That sounds about right on the time.
Right. Yeah, these years are going by way too fast. But we had heard there's a bit of a whisper and it might come back, you know. And I still didn't know I was coming back because I got sent away. So, you know, it was really like you don't know until, and you can't say anything until you're standing on set, you have your script and it's happening, because everything can get taken from you so quickly. So
yeah,
it was a weird time.
Yeah, and there's definitely no guarantees in the movie industry. You can be hearing about a project and it just it delays and delays. But I think that's just speak for me and everybody at the Drunk Panthers that we were so appreciative that the show got picked back up for that third season. Man, we were able to get somewhat of a, like, even if season three ends up being the last one, we got a nice, satisfying return of all these characters.
Yeah, I dressed up as a member of the Hopway for Halloween.
Right. You were Hopway for Halloween. That's
awesome. I love it. What a suave outfit, right? Like, it's so cool.
I should definitely have a picture of it right now. But you know what we'll do is we'll just throw a picture of it up, like, right now.
I think you should. But we wouldn't have gotten season three without the fans. The fans are what kind of brought us back, you know? Yeah. So huge shout out to them.
Yeah, hopefully we can get you guys back on season four, and you know, live will not be there, obviously, but we'll maybe catch a little glimpse of your side of your head.
A little Easter egg for you guys to see.
Absolutely, absolutely.
So maybe get like 4 flashback episodes.
Oh, that would be amazing. Like all the deads just come back on episode.
Oh, yeah, that would be awesome.
Bolo, Perry, me. Oh, yeah. Oh man, like I'm down.
I'm with it. But you know, before we get out of here, I just want to say thank you so much for joining us today. It was like, this has been a lot of fun. We can sit here and do this all day.
Oh, yeah. Me too. You've been amazing. Thank you.
Thank you. We're definitely going to have to reach out to somebody about this Girl Kills World. We're going to have that happen.
Get that off the ground.
Oh, I'm definitely voice acting for it. You know, for everybody out there, we're going to GoFundMe or something going.
Oh, yeah.
When I was just a little girl.
That's brilliant. I mean, I'm sold. I'm sold.
Hey guys,
out in Cape Town.
Guys, don't forget to check out Warrior seasons 1-3 on, and right now it's on Netflix. Right. At the time of this recording, but you know, streaming service would be weird. Just go Google it, yeah. And figure out which streaming service is on, and check out this wonderful series. Jenny, so thanks again so much for joining us and chatting with us today.
Thank you for having me, guys. I appreciate it.